Abu Hanifa said that I forbid people to pass opinions, to make judgments without analyzing my proof. I forbid those people without analyzing my proof to pass the opinion on my statements. That means unless you don't know the proofs, you do not give opinion on my statement. He forbid those people to make, without analyzing his proofs, to give their opinion on the statements of Abu Hanifa, according to a student, Zufar. Further we read that Imam Ibn Abdul Bar, Imam Ibn Abdul Bar, he writes, he was also an imam, he says, that Abu Hanifa said, Imam Abu Hanifa said, that the Sahih Hadith is my madhab. If you find a Sahih Hadith, that is my madhab. If you find any Sahih Hadith, that is my way of life. That is my madhab. And Abu Hanifa, may Allah please with him, he said, according to Muhammad, one of his students, he said that Abu Hanifa said, Imam Abu Hanifa said, that if you find any of my fatwa, any of my opinion, which goes against the Book of Allah and the sayings of the Messenger, you reject my opinion. That means if you find any opinion of Abu Hanifa, Imam Abu Hanifa, which goes against Allah and his Rasul, any Sahih Hadith which was madhab, then reject his opinion. So, when people ask me, that does my wudu break if accidentally I touch a woman or not? Or, if someone asks me, that after Surah Fatiha, do you say Ameen loudly or no? So I tell, that after Surah Fatiha, I say Ameen loudly. If the Imam is reading in the Fajr Salah, or Maghrib or Isha, the loud Salah, after he says, Ghayr al-Maghdubi wal-Dhalin, I say Ameen loudly. That's the reason I am a Pakka Hanafi. Abu Hanifa said that if you find any of my opinion, any of my fatwa, which goes against the Book of Allah or the Messenger, reject my fatwa. So I rejected the opinion of Abu Hanifa that don't say Ameen loudly, and I say Ameen loudly after Surah Fatiha. That's the reason I am a Pakka Hanafi. If Hanafi means a person who follows the teachings of Abu Hanifa, then I say I am a Pakka Hanafi, 100%. The other Hanafis, they are 60%, 70%. Sahih Hadith was his madhab. And according to Ibn Wahab, he says that one day some people came and asked Imam Malik that while doing wudu, do we have to wipe between the web spaces of the toes? Imam Malik said, the Prophet did not do that. It's not required. After everyone went away, Ibn Wahab, he told Imam Malik, and he quoted the hadith, and he gave the narration, and gave the name of the Ravi, that the Prophet, in wudu, he wiped his web spaces between the toes. So Imam Shafi said, yes, that is a good hadith, that's a Sahih hadith. And later on, whenever anyone asked Imam Malik, that should we wipe between the web spaces, between the toes, he said, yes. He changed his opinion. So whatever belongs to the Sahih hadith, his opinion was of the Sahih hadith. And Imam Malik, may Allah's mercy be on him, he said that I am a human being. I can err and sometimes I'm correct. I can err, I can make a mistake and sometimes I'm correct. But if any of my opinions go against the Book of Allah and his Messenger, discard my opinion. Same thing. If any of the opinions of Imam Malik, may Allah be pleased with him, he said, may Allah's mercy be on him, that if you find any of my fatwa, any of my opinion, which goes against Allah and the Rasul, reject my opinion, discard my opinion. So the Malikis, when they offer Salah, they put their hands at the side. But when we read in the Hadith of Abu Dawud, volume number 1, Hadith number 755 and 757 says that you should tie your hands below the navel, but it's a Zaif Hadith. Both these Hadith are Zaif, according to Imam Abu Dawud. Abu Dawud, volume number 1, Hadith number 756, says that keep the hand above the navel, which is more strong than the Zaif Hadith. But the next Hadith, Abu Dawud, volume number 1, Hadith number 758, it says that when you keep your hands during Salah on your chest, and it says this is a stronger Hadith, though this is a Mursal Hadith, Mursal means there is a link missing in between. But in the commentary it says it is the strongest than the other hadith. Even if you read the hadith of Sayyid ibn Khuzaymah, it says that the Prophet kept his hand on his chest when he offered salah. Even that is a Mursal hadith, but along with other hadith, Sheikh Nasiruddin al-Albani has classified it as sahih. So it is the strongest of all the hadith where to keep your hand. The strongest is keep on the chest. So when I offer my salah, I keep my hands on my chest. Therefore I say I am a pakka malaki. Imam Malik said, if you find any of my fatwa which goes against Allah and His Rasul, you reject my fatwa. So if the Maliki say that Imam Malik said keep your hands on the chest, the story is different, but assuming he said that. But he said, if you find my fatwa which goes against Allah and His Rasul, reject my fatwa. So I rejected his fatwa and I keep my hand on the chest. Therefore I am a pakka Maliki, 100% saufisad. The other Malikis, they are 60%, 70%. I am 100%. And if you read the history, during the Khalifa, the Caliphs of the Abbasid Caliphs, Abu Ja'far and Harun Rashid, both these two Caliphs, they wanted to print the fatwa of Imam Malik, known as Muwatta, the Muwatta Malik. He said no, because the companions of the Prophet, they are spread in different parts. My judgment is based on whatever limited knowledge I have. Because the companion, the Sahabas of the Prophet spread in different parts of the world, I cannot say for sure whether mine is correct or not. Therefore, he did not allow the Caliph to make his Muwatta as the law. He did not want to make his Madhab as the law of the state. Imagine, that was the thinking of Imam Malik. May Allah's mercy be on him. Next came Imam Shafi. Imam Shafi, he was a student of Imam Malik. He was also a student of the student of Abu Hanifa. And Imam Shafi said, it is not possible for any human being not to know a single hadith of the Prophet. So if you don't know some hadith, your fatwa can be wrong. So that's the reason he said that if you find any opinion of Imam Malik, or my opinion, or Imam Malik, or Al-Awzari, or Al-Thawri, look at where they got the opinion from. Means go to their source. And he said, do not follow my opinion blindly. Don't follow my opinion blindly. See where they got the opinion from. Go back. And Imam Shafi, may Allah's mercy be on him, Rahimullah, he said that if you find any sahih hadith, that is my madhab. So the madhab of Imam Shafi was of the sahih hadith. And he said, if you find any sahih hadith which goes against my opinion, reject my opinion. He also said that if you find any of my fatwa which goes against Allah and His Rasul, reject my fatwa. So then, if people ask me, that if I'm in wudu and if accidentally I touch a woman or a woman touches me, does my wudu break? I said no, my wudu does not break, because according to Sahih Hadith in Abu Dawud and Sahih Muslim, the wudu does not break. So therefore I'm a pakka Shafi. Because Imam Shafi said, if you find any of my fatwa, any of my opinion which goes against Allah and the opinion of the Prophet, any Sahih Hadith, you reject my fatwa. So that's the reason I'm a pakka Shafi. The other Shafi, they are 60% Shafi, 70%, 80%, not pakka, not 100%. I am saufisad Shafi. And if you know history, Imam Shafi, when he was in Baghdad, he wrote a book of his fatwas known as Al-Hujjah. Later on, when he traveled to Egypt and he came back, he studied under the students of Imam Layth ibn Sa'd. And he changed his fatwa. Many of his fatwas he changed. He wrote a new book, Al-Umm. So now we have a Qadim Shafi book, Al-Hujjah, and the Jadid, the new one, Al-Umm. That means Imam Shafi, when he learned under the students of Imam Layth, people have a misconception, there were only four Aimmas. There were several Aimmas. These four Aimmas, they became popular because the students made the teachings popular. There were other Imam, like Imam Layth ibn Sa'd. According to Imam Shafi, he said, though Imam Shafi was a student of Imam Malik, he said that Imam Layth was far superior in fiqh than Imam Malik also. Imam Shafi can say that, we can't say that. There were several other Aimmas.